Okay, hi everyone. Welcome to the first seminar of the Search and Matching in Macro and Finance virtual seminar series. We are very happy to have Pierre-Olivier Weill here from UCLA. He will present his paper, Inventory Market Making and Liquidity in the Corporate Bond Market, joint work with Mahyar Kargar from UIUC and Benjamin Lester from Philly Fed. To obtain more information about our seminar series and upcoming seminars, feel free to visit our website, SaMMF.com. So before we start, I would like to go over a couple of rules and procedures. So in addition to the presenter, we have a group of panelists, including Zach Betun, Bachimek Sambaleva. These two are also among the organizers of the seminar. Thierry Foucault, Jean-Edouard Colliard, Ricardo Lagos, and Burton Holyfield, as well as the co-authors, Mahyar and Ben. So the presenter, Pierre-Olivier, is going to speak for the first 45 minutes, followed by a 15 to 30 minutes Q&A session. Panelists will be able to ask questions at any point in time during the talk, but attendees can ask questions only in the designated Q&A session, or can use the Q&A feature of the Zoom to submit written questions and comments. So basically the Q&A button is at the bottom of your screen. So you can, if you have any question or comment, you can just type your question or comment. And the co-authors, Mahyar and Ben, they are going to be monitoring the questions, and they are going to answer, especially the clarifying question, while Pierre continues to present. So this is the first way an attendee can engage in the seminar. The second way, if you want to ask a question live during the Q&A session, Zoom has raise hand feature. So you can use Zoom's raise hand feature to indicate that you have a question during the Q&A session. Although we have 30 minutes for the scheduled Q&A session, it may still be unlikely that we take all questions or comments live, and we thank you all for being understanding if that happens. So I guess without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to the first speaker. So Pierre, you have 45 minutes.
Hi, everyone. First, I would like to thank the organizer for inviting this paper to the Search and Matching in Macro and Finance seminar. I also wanted to thank them for the initiative of organizing this seminar. I'm really looking forward, very excited to be able to all the seminars that are coming up, and to be able to hear about search and matching models in macro and finance every few weeks and discuss exciting recent work in the literature. I'm going to present today Inventory, Market Making, and Liquidity in the Corporate Bond Market. This is joint work with Mahyar Kargar and Ben Lester, who are panelists and be able to answer all the hard questions. I'm going to start with the main motivation for this work. The main motivation is an observation that we made in many papers and in the financial press as well, which is that in the corporate bond market, it looks like broker-dealers hold much lower level of inventories now than before. More precisely, if you use flow of funds data, to have a sense of how much inventories broker-dealer hold, you'll read that prior to the great financial crisis, broker-dealer would hold about 3% of the aggregate supply of corporate bonds. And prior to COVID-19 crisis, their inventories had fallen to less than 1%. So part of it is the fact that there are more corporate debt around, and part of it is that they also hold less in absolute value. In absolute terms. So why do they hold less? Many people have conjectured and argued that this is due to post-crisis regulation, such as the Volcker Rule, that give broker-dealer less of an incentive to hold assets on their balance sheet. And as a result, this has created concern that broker-dealer are less willing to provide liquidity to customer than before. And that has led to a pretty large empirical literature that tried to measure liquidity in the corporate bond market before and after post-crisis regulation for institutions that were, for broker-dealer that were impacted, the one bank affiliated with bank versus not by regulation. So one paper on the impact of post-crisis, post-great financial crisis regulation on corporate bond liquidity is due to Choi and Hu. What Choi and Hu do in their work, which we reproduced here, is measure the transactions costs that are paid by customers when they trade with dealers. So what they do is that they calculate the difference between the price paid by a customer and a reference interdealer price, multiply by two to get a round trip cost, and make sure they look at a sample of trade that exclude those trade in which customers seems to provide liquidity instead of demanding liquidity from dealers. And what they find is what you see on the slide. They find that prior to the crisis, transaction costs were, you know, give and take about 15 basis points. They increased a lot during the great financial crisis, and then they fell down to levels that were higher than before, maybe 25 basis points or so. So when you read the papers and financial press discussion about a trading cost in the corporate bond market, they are not only concerned with the trading costs they observed at the time, they're also concerned about the trading costs that would arise in the corporate bond market if a very bad shock were to hit that market. So if there were a big aggregate shock, a big sell-off of bonds. So we saw such an aggregate shock in the last month. So with Mahyar, Ben, and three graduate students from UCLA, David Lindsay, Shuo Liu, and Diego Suniga, in the last few months, we started to measure transaction costs in various ways, like the Choi and Hu, for instance, in the corporate bond market during the COVID-19 crisis. So the result of our measurement is one graph that you see on the slide. What that graph does is that it's the same measure as before, but measured at a daily basis, because we were interested in trading costs at a higher frequency. What you see is that early in the quarter, trading costs were about like 25 basis points. That's more or less what we saw before. And then they increased super fast, I guess much faster than during the great financial crisis, and to level that maybe are even higher than during the great financial crisis. We can debate about that. And they increase, so 100, 125, 150 basis points, and they fall down only after the Fed intervene and maybe create more balance sheet space for broker dealers. All right, so motivated by these observations, what we're doing in the present paper is develop a model of dealer intermediated over the counter market. And what we want to do is want to develop a model that use standard OTC market techniques, but in which inventory play a key input into intermediation activity. So the assumption we're going to make, which makes sense, but is not shared, I'll speak of the literature in a second, by all models, is that dealers must hold inventory in order to fulfill buy orders. Our goal is to use this model to quantitatively evaluate the impact of regulation plus perhaps other change that have happened in the market at the same time, you know, including the entry of new dealers, the possibility of doing market making without holding inventories, doing agency trade, or perhaps study the impact of change in liquidity demand, maybe the rise of...
Pierre-Olivier, I have a question about yeah. that. To which extent do we know that this is true? That is, my look at the data is that sometimes the dealers are short selling, in fact, in this market,
yep.
which suggests that they may not need inventory at all if they can short sell.
No, so there, it is true that, the way we want to, we're not going to do it right in this paper, but, or in the current version of this paper, but the way we want to think about that is in terms of dealers having several technology to provide liquidity. One of them would be to short sell. Another technology that they seem to use, and they have used more, some authors have shown after post-crisis regulation, is agency trade. So agency trade would be not exactly short selling, but matchmaking. So the amount of agency trade was developed by you and last year in his job market paper. So in his model, so the conceptualization of agency trade he makes is a bit like a limit order. So the idea is that a customer would give or communicate its trading interest to a dealer. The dealer would not trade with the customer until he find a counterparty and then match the two. So that would be a bit of an OTC market version of a limit order. So definitely we take, or not today, but we take very seriously the idea that there might be other ways to fulfill by order than using inventory, and to evaluate the impact of regulation. It's important to understand the extent to which dealers substitute away from, you know, market making with inventories to other technology. But yeah, I mean, we're with you on that. So as the third bullet point mentioned, for today we're gonna have more modest growth. So what we're presenting is work in progress. What we'll like to do is, you know, introduce the model, derive its general properties, and then we'll show a preliminary calibration. So the calibration exercise I'm going to show you later on works in the following way. We're going to try to calibrate the model to great financial crisis data, and then feed in the model an increase in inventory cost that creates a drop in inventory that's similar to the one we observe, and study the impact on liquidity, trading patterns, and wealth. And so one thing that is will be missing from the calibration is what Thierry has in mind, which is, you know, the substitution away from a trading technology that requires inventory towards a trading technology that does not. That's something we'd like to do in the future. All right, so let me speak briefly about the literature. Do you see the next slide? Let me see. It seems that we froze. Let me share my screen again. So I'm going to speak next about the related literature. So there's a large empirical literature on the topic. One such paper is the Choi and Hu paper. There's a number of other papers. Some of them are mentioned on the slide. Where our paper is going to fit very squarely is on the segment of the theoretical OTC market literature that studies what we call semi-centralized OTC markets. The OTC market in which dealers can trade together in a centralized market and only customers have to search for dealers. So one typical feature of the semi-centralized model of OTC market is that in the long run, so formally in a non-stochastic steady state, dealers have no incentive to hold inventory. And the reason is, and it's built in the model, is because dealers, when a dealer receives a buy order, he can source the asset immediately into the centralized interdealer market. So a dealer never has to hold inventory in advance in order to fulfill a buy order. What we're going to do in our framework is just take this model and add the assumption that dealers have to hold inventory in advance of receiving a buy order. And after they fulfill the buy order, they can go back on the centralized interdealer market and buy and replenish their inventory. So that's our contribution to this segment of the literature. This is not to say that there are not search and matching OTC market in which dealers or intermediation is inventory is not required for intermediation. There's a large literature in which inventories are used. And these are the fully decentralized OTC market models that have been quite popular in the last decade or so. There are many papers that have been written on the topic. Some of them are mentioned at the bottom of the slide. We like those fully decentralized OTC markets. So they are markets in which everyone has to search, including dealers. We decided against using fully decentralized OTC market because we think that these markets, so these models are very rich, but they're written in order to address empirical observation about inter-dealer trade. That's something we're less interested in today. We're going to be more interested in understanding trading patterns between dealers and customers. And for that, parsimony guided us towards using a model of semi-centralized OTC market instead of fully decentralized OTC market. As an aside, we believe, although we've not proved it, that our model is a natural limit of a semi-centralized OTC market where the rate of contact between dealers, so in the interior market, goes to infinity. All right, so having described the literature, I'm going to move on and describe the model. All right, so this slide describes the preference in the model. The description of preference is very similar to what you'll see in models such as Lagos and Rostro and Galeano in the early stage of the OTC market literature. So we're going to consider a model that's set in continuous time, in which one asset is traded. The supply of the asset is denoted by S. And the economy is going to be populated by a continuum of risk neutral and infinitely lived agents that, in keeping with the language that's used in the data, that we're going to call customers and dealers. And all those agents discount the future at the same rate, little r. The preference of the customer are described in the following way. So first, there's a measure one of customer, and second, customer are going to be able to hold asset in any quantity, and if they hold a quantity Q of the asset, we're going to assume that they derive a flow utility equal to little delta multiplied by U of Q, where U is a concave utility. So little delta is a preference shock, which changes over time and generate gains from trade. Precisely, we're going to assume that with intensity little gamma, a new shock is going to arrive and being drawn according to a CDF F. And the shocks are going to be drawn IID over time and across customers. The intermediation services are going to be provided by dealers. I'll tell you in a second how. The preference of the dealers are going to be described in the following way. So first is a measure mu d of dealers, and we're going to assume that dealers derive a marginal utility flow ud for holding asset. So this little ud is going to be playing a big role in our calibration because that's where we're going to build in inventory costs. So when I told you that we'll study what happens when we feed in the model and increase in inventory costs that produce a drop in inventory, blah, 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 what we'll do is reduce ud. All right, so now how is trading happening? So that's semi-centralized OTC market subject to what we call an inventory in advance constraint. So using language from the monetary literature, because formally this is very similar to a cash in advance constraint. So we'll assume more precisely that dealer can trade together in a centralized inter-dealer market, and that the only search there is between customers and dealers. So customer trade with dealers in a search market, which means in the model that with intensity lambda, a customer is going to contact with a dealer, and conditional on a contact, the customer is going to bargain with the dealer, and bargaining occurs under full information, so data is observed, and the outcome of the bargaining game, of the bargaining, so it's no game, is going to be described by the Nash, generalized Nash bargaining solution, where dealers have a bargaining power equal to theta. All right, so the innovation relative to earlier work is what we call the inventory in advance constraint. We're going to assume that dealers must hold inventory in advance of fulfilling a buy order. I have to hold some inventory, and the amount they can trade on that side of the market is going to be limited by how much inventory they hold. And inventories are going to be chosen, of course, in order to maximize expected profits. So there's some natural extension for later, going back to the question that Thierry asked earlier. So considering heterogeneous customer is something that looks interesting and promising, you know, maybe retail and institutional, for instance. Considering heterogeneous dealers seems also promising, especially if you want to understand the impact of regulation, because some dealers were impacted, some dealers were not. The entry of dealers also is interesting, and also using different trading technology is an interesting avenue for future work. Some of those you'll see are straightforward extension, at least at a theoretical level, of what we do. Others are harder. For now, I'm just going to focus on the simplest version of the model, which is the one we actually solve and the one we actually compute.
And so dealers are price takers in the centralized market?
In the interdealer market, they're price takers. So the interdealer market is centralized. And there's a continuum of dealers. So, all right, so there are two ways you might want to think of the interdealer market differently from what we do. I mean, at least two ways. So one would be to make it a search market. So that would be one way to create a monopolistic effect in the interdealer market. Another way would be more in line with your work, I guess, which is to have a finite number of dealers and imperfect competition between dealers. That'd be an interesting extension also of the standard model. It's not been done as far as I know, but would be something like a cross between the Figaro person and the uniform price auction models of Kyle, or recently Malamud and Rostec, etc. So I'm guessing there might be, I think there's some very interesting theoretical issue that would arise in that case, but we've not done that. We maintain perfect competition. The empirical motivation for perfectly competitive centralized dealer market is that, you know, although there's price dispersion between dealers, it's the magnitude of the price dispersion is typically lower than between dealers and customers. That's something that's very clear, for instance, in the municipal bond market that Burton studied first, and Green Holyfield and Schurhoff, and then in Leon Schurhoff. Compare the markups that dealer charge each other, and the one that charge customer, they're really of a different order of magnitude. All right, so now I'm going to start introduce more notation and describe the equilibrium. So I'm going to denote by V of delta Q the value of a customer with preference shock delta holding Q units of the asset. So value means maximum attainable utility. I'm going to denote by P star the interdealer price and I star the inventory per dealer. In a bilateral trade with dealers, what can be shown is that the usual property of semi-centralized OTC market holds, namely the trade is going to be chosen, so how much the customer wants to hold after trade, Q prime, in order to maximize the surplus. And the surplus is the difference between the maximum attainable utility after trade with the new holding Q prime before trade and the cost of acquiring the difference between Q prime and Q in the interdealer market. The difference with the standard model is that this optimization is now subject to the inventory constraint. The first order condition of this program is that the marginal value of the customer has to be greater than the price or equal to the price if the inventory constraint does not hold. Is not binding. So what you see is that, again, there's a standard property that holds, which is that terms of trade are all depend on the something you might call the marginal surplus, so the difference between the marginal value of the customer and the interdealer price. So that means that, you know, to characterize the model, all what we need to characterize is this marginal surplus, the difference between the marginal value of the customer and the interdealer price. And that marginal surplus, using the envelope theorem, can be shown to solve the Hamilton-Jacobi-Bellman equation that you see at the top of the slides. The first term in the HJB is the marginal flow utility. The second term is the user's cost, or the amount of money it costs per unit of time to hold one unit of the asset. The third term is associated with change in delta and change in the preference shock. And the last term is the one that is new in our setting. The last term, or more, to be more precise, is the one that will be zero in without the inventory in advance constraint, is a continuation marginal surplus. The continuation marginal surplus is not zero because the inventory in advance constraint might bind. So it might be the case that the customer in its trade with the dealer is not able to reduce its marginal value all the way to the interdealer price, or reduce its marginal surplus all the way to zero. So what that term does, that it makes the model a bit less tractable than what happened before. So it is no longer a closed form solution for the marginal surplus. However, it can be used, it can be studied using standard contraction mapping techniques. So you can show that it's increasing the preference shock, decreasing in the asset holding, decreasing in the interdealer price. And you know, maybe one new property for us is that it's decreasing in the inventory holding per dealer. And that's natural, because the inventory holding is what prevents customers from reducing their marginal surplus to zero when they're contacting dealers. That makes their margin, that elevates their marginal surplus above the value it could have other things equal. Economically, what that means is that that creates precautionary demand for holding assets. So if you anticipate that you know, later on it's going to be harder to buy, that makes you want to buy more in the first place. All right, so having solved for marginal surplus, we're going to discuss now trading strategies. Trading strategy of a customer is easy to describe in terms of a target holding. So we can, you know, imagine that we solve first for the asset holding that the customer would like to have in the absence of an inventory constraint. So the solution of the equation sigma equals zero, that the one that equates the marginal surplus to zero. Then the optimal strategy of the customer is going to be simply to get as close as possible to that target, subject to the inventory constraint. So to give a simple example, imagine that there are just two deltas, two preference shock, like in the figure 1%, for instance. Then there would be two targets, one associated with each preference shock, a low one for the low preference shock, a high one for the high preference shock. When a customer switched from the low preference shock to the high preference shock, he or she will want to adjust to the high target, but because of the inventory in advance constraint, might not be able to do it in one go. The customer will have to trade, in this example on the slide, twice. Once up to the inventory constraint and once less than inventory constraint. On the other side, meaning when the customer switched from high to low, from delta 2 to delta 1, but you see that there's an asymmetry. The customer will want to sell all its holding, will be able, sorry, to sell all its holding up to Q star delta 1 in one go the first time he or she contacts a dealer. So that means that, you know, this model has a very strong empirical implication that doesn't go all the way to addressing Thierry's question, but it's, you know, it's maybe an indirect way. You know, an immediate implication of that sort of structure is that it's going to imply that customers sell very in large lumps, and they're going to buy just progressively. So in the data, you should see that the number of customer bots, so the size of customer sale will be larger, and then in a stationary equilibrium, if the total amount of customer buy in dollars is the same as customer sale, which you see that the number of trade on the buy side will be larger than the sell side. That turns out to be true. So if you look at the table in Green, Holyfield, Shurhoff, you see that, you see that the number of trade on the buy side is larger than on the sell side. It's also true in the corporate bond market.
So Pierre, can I ask you a question?
Yep.
I mean, it's almost, I'll ask it anyways. I was going to say that the prediction seems a little sensitive to like modeling assumptions, but now you're showing it looks true. But in the sense that, you know, the dealer has the usual deep pockets. So you could imagine the dealer runs out of available credit or like, you know, means of payment to pay, in which case he might not be able to absorb the whole thing.
It would be the other side of the...
Right. So you might get some symmetry in the theory.
Absolutely. No, so I mean, that's the point well taken. So we looked at just one side, one possible constraint. The other one is also plausible. Yes. So all right. So now, you know, what do we see in the data? If you think of it, it's in the data we see quite consistently an asymmetry that goes in our direction. Right? So, what you seem to see is that the number of customers sold is larger, smaller than the number of customers. All right, so.
Clarifying question, Pierre.
Go ahead.
The sigma, so was that the surplus of the dealer or the total gains from trade?
So, all right, so the sigma is the marginal surplus of a trade between a customer and a dealer.
So it's the gains from trade between the dealer.
From trade, yeah. So it's okay. The difference between the marginal value of the customer and that of the dealer, which is the interdealer price.
Okay, thank you.
And another question. What is, I think you mentioned it, but what is the frequency at which dealers get access to the interdealer market?
So they
access continuously or?
Continuously. The only thing that they cannot have access to it when they meet a customer. That's what makes the entire model attractive. So one way to think of it is as the limit of a model in which we've not proved that it's indeed the limit, but we're conjecturing it is, the limit of a model in which there are two Poisson processes, one for contacting customer and one for contacting dealers. And the speed at which dealers are contacted goes to infinity. So, you know, if those contacts between customers and dealers arrive at independent Poisson processes, you're never going to be able to contact dealers at the same time as contact customers. So even in the limit, you'll be forced to hold inventories to trade with customers. And then very quickly after that, you'll replenish your inventory.
Can you go back to your data picture?
Yep.
So what are we plotting here?
So we're plotting on the academic trace data, the month by month, the ratio of the total number of customers sold to the total number of customer bought for corporate bonds that are off the run. So 90 days after issuance.
And total number of customers sold means the number of customers you sell to, or means the number of
trades that are flagged as customers sell to dealers. We don't know more than that actually. So,
and then just like one question about your model. Mm-hmm. So if I'm a dealer and I buy, how often do I end up selling to other dealers?
All right. So if you buy from a customer, you mean?
Yeah.
So you would, because of the competitive market, it's a bit, the model doesn't have a very precise prediction about volume, usually as usual. Mm-hmm. But you might make the following decision as a modeler of saying that, if you buy as from a customer, you had your inventory, you're just going to sell whatever inventory, extra amount you bought from the customer to the interdealer market.
I see.
But because, yeah.
And so if you look at the profits these guys make, there's some profits from buying it from a customer and some profits from selling it to a customer somehow. Does that, do you have any idea how that splits up in your model?
So we're starting to do that actually. Okay. So it's true. So what you're saying, there are going to be asymmetries on the quantity, but also on prices. So this Choi and Hoo merger, in principle, can be calculated on the buy side and the sell side, right? You could think of the how much markup you make and how much markdown you make as a dealer. So we started to look at that. We found with certain merger, it goes in one direction, another merger in the other direction. We also started to think of it theoretically. So it turns out that theoretically, even without an inventory in advance constraint, there are symmetries. And if you know Duffy-Gallon person, you can remember that in Duffy-Gallon person, there are symmetries between transaction costs on the buy side and the sell side. Like in the leading parameterization of Duffy-Gallon person, there's no transaction cost on the ask side. So the interior price is equal to the ask, and all the transaction costs are on the sell side. Sorry, on the bid side. One intuition for the Duffy-Gallon person for why this is the case is that in their leading parameterization, the customer who sell to dealer is the elastic side of the market. They're super elastic. They're indifferent between selling or not. So that intuition kind of suggests that the market are going to be very small. Actually, they are zero, and all everything is a markdown on the bid side. So it's also true in the type of model we are considering. Actually, if we assume away the inventory in advance constraint, there are already asymmetries. We've been able to derive, like last week, theoretical condition for the asymmetry to go in one versus the other direction. What the inventory in advance constraint is going to do, at least numerically, from what we're able to see, is produce an asymmetry that always goes in the same direction, which is of making the transaction cost on the buy side. So when a customer buy from a customer, from a dealer, larger than on the sales side.
Okay.
But depending on the parameterization, the net effect, you know, with the one that's already built in the model, could make the asymmetry the other way. So we're still trying to determine that.
Okay. Thank you. That's helpful.
Pierre, you have 10 minutes.
10 minutes?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Sorry. We'll have to negotiate ex post. All right. So I'll tell you very quickly about the stationary distribution. So we're moving towards trying to think about the dealer's problems. For that, we need to solve for the stationary distribution of preferential of assets in the customer population. The reason is that dealers choose their inventory in advance of contacting customer, and they don't know. They have to have rational expectation about which type of customer they're going to meet. To solve for stationary distribution, we no longer can solve for it in closed form. However, standard techniques, again, can apply, and a lot can be said. And the reason is that, although we cannot solve for distribution in closed form, we can, what you see on the slide is we can study a Markov process for the preference shock on the asset holding that's obtained when you sample the preference shock and the asset holding of a customer, whenever that customer changes type or whenever that customer contacts a dealer. That's a discrete time now, Markov process, whose transition probability function can be written in closed form, that's what you see on the slide. And with knowledge of the transition probability function, we can assert stuff about the stationary distribution. So now going to the dealer problem, the dealer problem is going to maximize its expected flow profit. The flow profit have the following components. The first one is the flow utility, net of the cost of holding the asset for a small amount of time. And the second component is the expected profit from selling to customer. So you see that there's an intensity term, there's a bargaining power term, and then the average surplus that is created when trading with customer. That average surplus depends on inventories because of the inventory constraint. And that second term makes the dealer problem concave. And the first order condition can be obtained by envelope. The first order condition is that R times pi star has to be greater than the flow utility derived by the dealer, plus its expected marginal profit from trading with customer. Marginal now with respect to I, with respect to inventory. So what you see here is that, you know, holding more inventory, as you might expect, is going to be valuable for dealers only to the extent that it relaxes the inventory constraint. It allows the dealer to increase the surplus in those trades that were constrained for which the marginal surplus was strictly positive. All right, so now an equilibrium is made up of the following objects. There's a marginal surplus function, distribution, inventory per dealer, inter-dealer market price, such that the HJB for the marginal surplus hold, the distribution is stationary, the inventory solved the first order condition of the dealer, and the asset market. The asset market clear just means that all the assets are here. At the end of the day, what we have is two equations and two unknowns, effectively. The two unknowns are the inventory per dealer and the market price. The two equations is the first order condition of the dealer for the inventory per dealer and the market clearing condition. It turns out that one of the equations is much easier to study than the other. The market clearing condition is nice, well-behaved function of price holding inventory fixed. So the inventory, the first order condition of dealer is a bit more complicated. So what that means is that to show equilibrium existence, I got a problem with my screen freezing. Let me share again. To show existence, the natural way to go is to back solve for equilibrium. What that means is that what you can do is solve for equilibrium, taking as given the inventory per dealer. So if you fix inventory per dealer for some value, you can solve for the equilibrium price. And then you can look at the first order condition of dealer and figure out what is the flow utility of the dealer that makes it optimal for the dealer to hold that level of inventory. And you can do that for all level of inventory. So for inventory zero would be very low flow utilities. And then you can solve for the locus of all those UDs that make it optimal for dealers to hold I star for all possible I star. And you can see that when you do that, you're tracing out all equilibria. So that gives you equilibrium existence. And that, possibly also allows you to figure out whether or not there are multiple equilibria. If you have any non-monotonicity in that schedule, then you would spot multiple equilibria. We've not been able to find multiple equilibria so far, but I know Ricardo's work suggests that there might be some. For now, in our numerical example, there's none. All right, so I guess I have very little time to tell you about the calibration. Let me tell you very briefly what we do. So we have a long but not crazy long list of parameters to pick. We're going to set some of those parameters to either standard values, or what I mean is that values have been considered elsewhere in the literature, or normalize them. And then the parameter we end up focusing on in the calibration are the elasticity of the utility flow function, the dispersion of preference shock. The level really has not much of a meaning. The intensity of preference shock, the bargaining power of the dealer, and the utility flow of dealers. For the elasticity of the utility flow function, so we don't exactly know what the best way to go, but one approach to set it is to note that this elasticity of the utility flow function determines the price elasticity of supply in the OTC market. And price elasticity of supply is something that's been measured in many financial markets using natural experiments like stock or asset deletion from index. And there's some recent work in the corporate bond market by Dick Nielsen and Rossi that does not measure the elasticity, the price elasticity of supply directly, but if you look at their table, you can do a back of the envelope calculation for that. And that suggests to us that maybe sigma equal 5, so that would be a price elasticity of supply of 0.2, is a reasonable number. And there are other ways we could go. One way would be, that's Burton's idea, I guess, we could just to focus on the asymmetries created by the model, we could pick a sigma that make transaction costs on the buy side and sell side the same in the absence of inventory constraints. That would be sigma equal 2 we discovered last week. The last four parameters are set based on measurement of the trace data. So first, for the dispersion of delta of the preference shock, we look at the standard deviation of log trace trade size. For the bargaining power, we match the level of trading costs pre-financial, great financial crisis. The shock intensity, we use a measure of turnover. And the flow utility of dealers, we set it so that the model creates the asymmetry between the ratio of the number of customers sold to customer bought that we observe in the data. Oh, by the way, going back to Burton's question. So Burton was, do we create asymmetry in trading costs? And I answered yes, but there's already asymmetry in the absence of inventory constraint. For the number of customers sold to customer bought with IID preferential, there are no asymmetry in the absence of inventory in advance constraint. It can be shown that the number of customer buy and customer sold are the same. And so here, the only, according to the model, the only asymmetry here is created by the inventory in advance constraint.
So Pierre, why not try to match the ratio of desired inventory to supply, outstanding supply for the asset, I star over S.
Oh, so, okay, so...
the initial motivation that will make sense. I mean, you want to...
So we do that, actually. Okay, I went very fast. We do something related. So the desired inventory is not something we observe directly because that's an inventory per dealer. However, we can match, and we do match, the total amount of inventory in the dealer sector. So that is something we do by... So that pins down mu d, so the number of dealers. If you have an idea on how to figure out what is I star, the desired measure level of inventory, be great. But we don't. I mean, it's hard to measure inventory.
But number of dealers you can observe in the trace data. Yeah. So of course this is not mu d. I mean, I guess mu d is something like number of dealers divided by number of clients.
Yeah.
So,
in previous work with Ben and Julien Grenier, we thought very hard. We tried to think, I mean, as hard as we could, I guess, about what's number of clients, because we're in a model that was not scale-free. The one we have here is homogeneous, so we had to determine what's the supply per capita for calibration. Here, it can be normalized. So you can just multiply S and multiply delta by appropriate constant to obtain exactly the same implications. So we're still searching for meaningful targets, as you mentioned. But that, anyway, that's what we have for now. All right, so I'm next. All right, I think I'm out of time, but I'll steal 3 more minutes to show you a few graphs. So here's what we do now. So just one thing. How is the model pre-financial crisis? All right, so the outcome turns out kind of similar as what you would get without an inventory in advance constraint. I mean, the trading pattern is a bit different because you have the asymmetry, but the trading cost and the yield spread are not too different from what you would obtain without the inventory in advance constraint. So it looked like the market looked, that was not too binding. Now, what we're going to do is feed an increase in inventory cost that creates a large drop of high-rate inventory similar to one we see in the data. And we're going to see large difference with them or without inventory in advanced constraint. So that's what we do. We increase the inventory cost in percentage term from about 5%. That's our estimated or calibrated number prior to the crisis to, depend like 40% and up to produce a very large decrease in inventory holding. We obtained that training cost increased by a lot, actually by an amount that's not too different from what we saw in the data. We see a decrease in the ratio of customer sold to customer bought. That's the asymmetry. That's probably a bit too large relative to what we had in the data. So maybe Ricardo is right, we should have an offsetting force. We see yield spread increasing, so from 6 to 12, they double. Remember, these are large numbers. Huh? We have perpetuity, so the duration is 20. This corresponds to large impact on prices. And then welfare, so that's something you can do with an advantage of using a model. So we measure the loss gain from trade. So loss gain from trade is the following measure of welfare. It's a difference between, on the numerator, welfare in the first best and welfare in the model, divided by the total gain from trade measured as the difference between welfare in the first best and welfare in autarky, assuming that market are completely shut down. So you see that the loss gain from trade pre-financial crisis were about 1.8%, and they are very similar to what you would get without the inventory in advance constraint. And then they increase by a lot according to the calibration from 1.8 to 3% and more. All right, so I have used my time limit a bit already, so I'm going to conclude. We provide a framework to study the impact of regulation on liquidity provision. And our goal going forward is to incorporate other market developments, other trading technology, as Thierry suggested, and perhaps also study through the lens of the model recent development during the COVID-19 crisis. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Pierre, for the great presentation. So before opening up the Q&A for attendees, is there any more questions from panelists?
I have one question or suggestion maybe. So I understood the argument that this is the limit of a model in which you could contact the interdealer market at Poisson shocks and so on. But if there is any hope of solving the more general model, I think it would be interesting because you could look at the cross-section of assets and say, assets for which that are more liquid and you are more likely to find a dealer to get the bond and then sell it, then maybe the asymmetry is less pronounced. So you could test this type of prediction in the cross-section, which should be quite interesting, I think.
So SaMMF has techniques for that that could be, I'm guessing, could be used. That would... All right, so we could do it numerically, and we could that would impose. So the drawback for now is that it would impose a parametric restriction on the utility flow function. So maybe you think that's something that's not really observed, and we should not feel too bad about that. The parametric restriction is that it's a linear marginal utility, and it turns out, again, something we discovered last week, that it implies symmetry, at least in our case, between transaction costs on the buy and the sell side. But that's a good point. Yes, that we went for our models because of we thought it was a transparent and easier way to start. But when we could go all the way and use a SaMMF technique to study what happened.
Just a suggestion, because all the evidence you mentioned is very nice, but these are really, it's time series evidence. It's really looking at the aggregate market. Mm-hmm. I was thinking that maybe you could have richer predictions using the cross-section a bit, and that would be okay. A way to do that.
I mean, this being said, we might have ways to... all right, so another reason we went for a semi-centralized model is because maybe in the spirit of your question, we feel, I mean, at least experience suggests that it's a place where we can enrich the model relatively easily. You can see that, I mean, from the formulation of the customer problem, etc., it's straightforward, theoretically, at least, to add customer heterogeneity. That might help a bit with the time series evidence, which will allow to build in the model other things that go on at the same time. We have some hope that we can think of entry in a relatively straightforward way, at least computationally, that maybe we'll be able to have different trading technology in the spirit of Thierry's question. So that guided our modeling choice at the moment. But you know, I agree, you know, the microscope in the data is on the intra-dealer trade. It's where it is. That's the data we have. So that means that it's kind of important to have more with intra-dealer trade, even though the transaction costs are low.
Here, can I ask you something about trying to tie it back to the facts at the beginning?
Yep.
So the motivating facts were, you know, the increasing spreads in the great financial crisis, and then now this COVID.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I guess without the inventory constraint, I mean, a natural, I don't know, one way through the lens of the, I want to understand through the lens of the model, what do we learn about this? One possibility could be spreads in valuation might give you that.
Yeah.
You know, like even without inventory constraints. So these times of uncertainty, then you spread the valuation distribution. I'm guessing you will get an increase in the width of the beta spreads.
Yeah, correct. Okay.
But for that, we don't need the inventory constraint. So is it an issue about, I don't know, one possibility would be that this is inventory risk or something.
Mm-hmm.
But that's the more traditional inventory models would give you that if you're, you know, you have to compensate the dealer for the risk of holding the inventory in riskier times.
Okay. So let me share my screen again. I mean, I agree with you. And I disagree with you. So I'm going to... where is that? I'm going to go back to that picture. So I'm just going to highlight... so the way I'm interpreting Ricardo's question is that he's telling us about the yellow area. He's telling us about this temporary, I mean, not so temporary, but a very large increase in spread during the great financial crisis. And I agree, for that, you might need, I mean, it might be enough to think of a rise in uncertainty, et cetera. What we're trying to argue this model will be is about is about the orange lines, and that's a lot of what the data work has been about. So the increase in transaction costs from before the financial crisis to after, so you know, after 2010, etc.
So through the lens of the model, you interpret that as a binding inventory advance constraint or something.
Yeah, that's okay. So it's this idea of we're looking at some longer run.
I see.
Evidence.
But then what about the COVID then? Because there were no regulatory changes.
So the COVID, all right, okay, so that's interesting. So the COVID, to study the rising, all right, so.
The answer could be you must have a COVID slide, then that's okay.
So all right, so there are two things. So one is so it's a bit of a, like in our joint work, I mean, if you want to think about what's going on to the COVID crisis, then, and it goes back to Jean-Edouard's question, we should not think about steady state in this case, right? We should think of what happened when there's a large shock hitting the market. And that large shock could be, as you said, something to preference. And then the question would be to understand what's the response of the market to that large shock. Some of the response might be accounted just by the increase in preference and not by the inventory in advance constraint. We don't know, we didn't do the exercise, but it'd be interesting, we think, to think of what could be accounted for by the inventory in advance constraint.
So can I ask a question, the last one? So your constraint, like we talked about, is asymmetric. So I mean, could this have an impact on the half spread? Like, you know, is it the half spread should respond more? Could that be like a smoking gun to look at?
Yep.
As opposed to just the full spread?
That's right. Yeah, so that's Burton. It's very similar to Burton's question.
Okay, sorry.
Yes, so we're looking at that right now. And we're looking, we've been some of the, maybe in the last 2-3 weeks, we found conflicting evidence for now, depending on the measure of transaction costs we use. So if you look at implied round trip costs, like what Peter Feldhuter used in his work, we found asymmetry that were more in our direction, and Choi and Hu in the other. So we're still trying to sort out what's happening there. But we agree with you on this, yes.
You had a quick question, some more clarification, I think. Yep. I'm trying to understand about the precautionary motive and how it kind of determines the steady state distribution of assets across these types. It seems like there's two forces. Like, say I'm a low type guy.
Yep.
I may have a precautionary motive that I want to build up assets because it's likely that I'm going to find someone to sell to, and I need a lot of assets to sell to them. And then I also may want to build up assets because I know tomorrow I may be a high type guy to get a perfect shot. So I think one way, I'm trying to understand how those two forces interact, and then eventually so determines misallocation.
Can you repeat the second force? I'm sorry about that.
Yeah, precautionary savings, because I think I may value the asset tomorrow.
Yeah.
I get a perfect shot.
And the other one, sorry?
And the other one is, if I'm a low type guy, I'm a likely seller. So I may have a precautionary motive as a seller to really build up my inventory in order to sell, right? And those should be the low type guys, I think.
So, okay. So what we know from Lagos-Rochetot is that they are impact, friction have impact on both sides of the market, right? If you want to, the search friction, not the inventory one, right? Makes you want to buy less and sell less. And you want to sell less in the anticipation that you might want to buy later, and buy less in anticipation that, because you know that you might want to sell later when you switch to a low type. The inventory constraint seems to have only impact on one, but you know, on one side. But again, because it raises uniformly the all else equal the marginal value. So of course, you know, in equilibrium, it cannot be that everyone holds more. So it's what has to happen that the price adjusts.
So I guess now we can move on with the questions from attendees. So if you raise your hand, then we are going to allow you to speak. So Wei Chui has a question. So now
you'll
be unmuted.
Hi, Pierre. Hi. Thanks for your talk. I enjoyed it very much. So two quick questions. One is, will the intermediaries save enough to undo the inventory's constraints? Second is, in the data, in the model, I guess we may have spectrum of inventory constraints across different assets. We may have inventory constraint for government bonds, which may be different from corporate bonds. Mm-hmm. Do we know something about switching between these two? And what if we have different assets in the model? Thanks.
Okay. So can you repeat the first part of the question? Say, do...
Yeah. So because there are precautionary savings motives...
Oh, for customers.
Would they build up enough inventories so that this constraint is not going to bind in the end? Maybe there's some idiosyncratic risk that prevents this happening, but I would like to know.
So you want to know if dealer will build enough inventories, right? So with inventory costs, they are never going to fully undo it, right? Because they have to be compensated for for holding inventory. So it has to be the case that the marginal, the average marginal surplus that's created by trade with customer is strictly positive. Then quantitatively, there's another question, you know, how big is that? In our pre-crisis calibration, it's not too big. And then in our post-great financial crisis calibration, is much bigger. Now, as far as inventory constraint and how they might bind differently across different bond categories, et cetera, is an excellent question. We're in the process, as I said, to develop transaction cost measures that for which we can measure the smoking gun that Ricardo mentioned, the asymmetries in transaction cost or in number of buyers sold. But that's, you know, that's an excellent question. We're in the process of building up the empirical muscles that we need to do.
Yeah, it could be a very interesting question in terms of whether the government actually wants this to be binding. I mean, in terms of regulation, this could be an optimal outcome in terms of financial distortions in some markets.
It
relates to your previous point on steady state changes in this trading costs.
So,
Pierre, can I add one thing there?
Yep.
Sorry. So, just to push your answer a little bit further. Okay. So we've just gotten access to the regulatory version of TRACE.
Okay.
So that means we can identify the dealers themselves. And then you can try to put some numbers on the costs the regulated and non-regulated dealers are dealing with. And you can look at the inventory accumulation across different types of banks. This goes to Ricardo's question a little bit also, which might provide some empirical tests of the theory, right? The relationship between this sort of cost of holding inventory, the amount of inventory you hold, and the spreads that you charge.
Thanks, Ben.
So, can I ask a follow-up question about that? What happens to the dealers' holding periods for the intermediation over this time? Are they holding things longer or shorter in inventory? Do you know anything about that?
Do we know? I don't think we looked at too. So you have in mind doing some last in, first out analysis of the inventory duration? So we've not done that. Yeah, that's a good point. Again, you know, our model does not really speak directly to that, but nevertheless might be interesting to look at that in the data.
It was a data question, actually. It's just like what's been happening to that recently.
Mm-hmm. Oh, recently?
Yeah.
Can I say something?
Oh, so we don't have, go ahead, yes.
So we just, what we did, we looked at basically ratio of agency versus principal trade. So agency, we defined the trades that are only in inventories for 15 minutes. So if you look at the crisis, the ratio actually went up, meaning that there are more trades that are principal trades, meaning that dealers have to hold inventory. So we don't have a precise like notation of the time in which the assets are held in inventories, but you see that the ratio of the principal trades actually went up during the crisis.
No, down.
The agency.
Went down, sorry. Yeah.
More agency trade, less principal.
Yeah, that's what I meant, sorry.
So that could correspond to very short holding periods, a lot of matchmaking and less inventory taking.
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks.
Is there any more question from the attendees? So if you raise your hand.
Vishwanathan, he was asking a question. Maybe we can allow him to ask a question. Sammy?
Yes. Let me find him. Okay. Vish, you are should be unmuted now.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah.
So I guess the question was went back to Ricardo's question, which was, you would think that in most of this crisis there is a flight to quality, so people would dump corporate bonds, so the constraint that would bind would not be this I need inventories to purchase. Mm-hmm. It would be more that, you know, I don't have enough capital to hold all the inventories that people are dumping on me. And so that would be my sense, that these crises generally involve flights to quality until the Fed interferes. But you're suggesting it goes the other way. And the question is, how would you sort the two?
So the inventory costs is going to continue to matter. And now it's going to matter more in the way you're interested in, right? It's still the case that dealers are reluctant to hold assets, right? And so that will also impact their inventory holding strategy. So we should expect an effect. Will it show up?
I would just add one thing. I mean, we were sort of talking about this a little bit in the chat or the Q&A, or yeah. I don't know what window. So everything I've read about what was sort of behind this sort of extreme lack of liquidity during that 1 week in March, and we've looked at it in this other project we're doing, where if you look at the amount of inventory that dealers absorb during this week of enormous selling pressure, they actually, like, their net holdings went down, right? So there's something that was making dealers very hesitant to absorb inventory at the moment the market needed them to. And then that pressure eased. You can see on the starting the 23rd, the inventory they take, they absorb, shoots off like a rocket, basically, after the secondary market credit facilities open up. So we take that as a sign that it's important to understand what are the sort of balance sheet costs that these dealers are worried about, and why at various times are they hesitant to take on these inventories, in which case, you know, they would charge large spreads, which is exactly kind of what we saw them do during that week to take inventory on in a principal sort of trade, right? So I think, you know, using the model to get a quantitative sense of what these balance sheet costs are, given Dodd-Frank, Volcker rule, all these kind of things, and then running those numbers through a sort of shock to huge amounts of selling pressure, I think could get a little bit at your question, if that makes sense.
Okay, I think we have one last question. Do you want to let Guillermo Ordonez ask a question? Sammy?
Hello? Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, hi, Guillermo.
Hi, how are you? No, I think this is very related to what we were just talking with Vish. And basically, the question was related to what Ben was saying. I was asking what happened with inventories during this crisis, in particular in the recent ones. Mm-hmm. Because it's interesting that in your shadow value, you have the value of holding inventories, and at the same time, you have a cost of holding inventories, kind of mm-hmm. parametrically. And
yeah.
Those two be related in a way, because yeah. It sounds that in the recent crisis, maybe the value of holding inventories is really related to how costly it is mm-hmm. to hold them in a way.
Yeah.
So putting some discipline, that's why I was just talking to Ben and a little bit on the chat. So I think I don't have much of a question.
So I want to add something about, you know, so you're right. In a crisis type situation, so in the length of the month would be outside steady state, outside non-stochastic steady state, those inventory costs are going to matter not only for trading costs, but also for expected return on holding inventory.
Right, exactly.
So, in earlier work, with what we've done, a while back, major market paper, for instance, you had a situation in which there was essentially no impact on trading costs, but the inventory cost was entirely, could not be seen in the trading cost. but was seen only in the return from holding inventory. So it had an impact on the path of the interdealer price and not on the trading cost.
Right. So a little bit, and let me just finish with this. A little bit, my question is related to your initial motivation. Mm-hmm. So the increase in the reduction in inventory can be some regulatory cost, which is kind of exogenous, yeah. Parametric, yeah. Or it can be that we're living after the crisis in a more uncertain world, and it's costly just to hold them for uncertainty risk. I mean, it's costly to hold those assets.
Yeah.
And it can be endogenous increase in the cost. That's what.
So, it's absolutely right. So that's, I mean, the advantage of a structural model that would allow you to try to parse out a little bit of those various effects. But you'd expect that, I mean, so one narrative is prior to the Fed intervention, you know, who knows how long dealers would have to hold inventories. And now the Fed intervened and, you know, they know that the secondary market facility will eventually buy assets in May. And, you know, now it's all right. They would hold the asset for a month or two and then, you know, send them to BlackRock. And that's the reason they were willing to build up inventories.
Thanks.
So again, we thank Pierre for the great seminar, and we thank all panelists and attendees for the lively discussion.
Thanks to the organizer.
We hope you all enjoy the seminar. The next one is going to be in 2 weeks on Monday, the same time. And Ricardo Lagos will be our second speaker. So we are hoping to see you all there.
Thank you.